Hello everyone. Today we are talking with David Pollard, co-founder of Sapien Innovation and lecturer in technology enhanced learning. Hello, David.
Hello, thanks for having me.
Tell us a little bit about Sapien Innovation.
Good question. Sapien Innovation, really in a nutshell, looks at supporting people in education or in corporates or in startups to take ideas out of their head and put them into a real world scenario. So that could be looking at challenges that a university might have with students and being able to support them through a design sprint to get to a point where they feel comfortable rolling out and evaluating a solution to whatever challenge that might be. Or it could be working with a corporate or maybe medium enterprise to look at maybe some of the challenges that they have with some of their staff, whether it's around learning and development, or whether it's in the space of entrepreneurship and that space as well. And we'll walk them through, I suppose, an adapted process. So try and understand what are their needs and then build on that. It's kind of the fun part of all of entrepreneurship, where you're, you know, getting those ideas and putting them into practice. So I really like it. It's really fun. Obviously, doing that with Colin Keogh, who he's the engineer. So I would say I'm the fluffy one on the far side of who we are. And also we have supported and founded in the recent times, in the last couple of months, the open source ventilator project. So that was really interesting. We looked at trying to create an open source emergency field ventilator for people who were struggling to breathe due to coronavirus challenges. So that was interesting, and that grew to about 5,000 volunteers in the space of, I think, maybe 3 or 4 weeks, which was really exciting. And then other projects developed out of that, some around education. So looking at how you support people within refugee camps to learn about some of the different things around, you know, whether it's DIY face masks using plastic materials that are available to them, or just simply, you know, accessing clean water and supporting them within those spaces as well. So it was really interesting. A lot of support from really interesting people. Amazon and Ford engineers got on board, and it was just, yeah, it was a bit wild. So it was almost like scaling a startup from 3 people to I think like 5,000 within that space. But we're wrapping up that side of it at the moment, and now we're just going back to hopefully the normality, where we'll be working a lot with the likes of Trinity College here in Dublin, and also the Technical University in Dublin, where we're going to be working with them for the first time to look at actually some of the challenges that the lockdown and quarantine and the push to remote learning has kind of impacted on the university itself and on the students, but also the staff as well, and try and get them into a couple of streams for projects to support them to kind of get to a point where they feel that they can feel a bit more comfortable in that space and hopefully give a good learning experience and teaching experience to both staff and students within that. That's my short answer.
You've been involved in the edtech field for many years. What is the edtech landscape in Ireland, and what was the evolution of the edtech community?
Yeah, I got involved with the edtech community, it must be maybe 6 years ago, 7 years ago now. And my very first Techstars Startup Weekend was an educational technologies startup weekend, which, you know, you'll know very well. And that was my first taste of it. I guess I was brought on board that organizing team as the token educator, because we had all the entrepreneurs, we had all the business people, we had the designers and developers, and that team at the time didn't have someone in education. So they reached out to me actually on Twitter and said, you know, will you come on board? And I'll be honest, I didn't really know too much about startups at the time. But I knew educational technologies, and my focus was always using them for purpose as opposed to just doing them for fun. You know, obviously as educators, we all get a bit excited about new technology just because we get to try something new and we get to learn by doing that. But, you know, putting it into a real world scenario is totally different. It should be student focused, and it should be focused on what is the actual impact. That was my first space. So I went in for that 3 day. So for anyone who doesn't know what a startup weekend is, it's basically a 3 day hackathon where you come in with an idea, and by the end of it, you're supported by people within that industry and others who have different skill sets to yours to join a team and come up with a startup idea and hopefully progress that, you know, if that's what you want to do. but lots of learning within that. At the end of that event, myself and two other of the co-organizers of that event, we were sitting around a table and we were looking around us, and we saw a lot of people with lots of excitement within this space, because we weren't too sure, you know, if anyone would even come to an educational technology event. It's a very niche space, but there was a lot of people there. And what excited us was that they were staying around, they were having conversations, and we decided we were going to create a community for them in Dublin. We set up a community called Learning Tech Labs, and that grew to, I think, about 3,500 people before I left it about a year ago. That was an open community that ran events specifically around educational technologies, learning and development in all fields. That was the focus, and all of that was volunteer-led, volunteer-run as well. The aim to bring people together who were from different backgrounds to talk about what are the challenges that were there. It was really interesting to see, and we got a lot of support from more established organizations there. Trinity College came on board. They have a group there called Learnovate, and they look at specifically supporting startups within research and development in the educational technology space. So finding them grants, finding them opportunities to grow within that space. They were very supportive, gave us space, gave us speakers, gave us an understanding of where we could fit in this space, and we were very much grassroots. So there was that lack. There was a lack at the time in the last 3 or 4 years, even a bit longer, for this grassroots area. So there was, you know, learning and development, all of the corporate stuff, but there was no sense of community within Dublin itself. That was where we decided we could find the most value. Within that, then, we've seen a lot of people who've come and talked at those events, who've engaged with us, go on building startups, getting involved, and it's been really exciting. In Ireland, education will be seen as, I suppose, very crucial and a core part of, we take pride in our education system, even though it's not perfect and there's plenty of mistakes with it, and that's another topic for another time. It's all about creating solutions to challenges. So, for example, Patricia Scanlon, who runs Soapbox Labs, I think they got about 5.8 million investment there in the last year or so. Which are looking at voice recognition and voice speech learning for children. So they are looking at artificial intelligence and how you can support children to learn better within that space. Listening to her from being a parent herself all the way through to creating a solution that didn't only impact people that were around her, but also in the wider space was really impactful. And I think like the likes of that, those stories where you've seen a company like that grow, has really boosted the sense of importance of the educational technology ecosystem here in Ireland. It's been great because then we started to run these startup weekends more consistently, and we were getting support from the likes of IBM to run those, the likes of Udemy, who were an online learning platform, and they were giving us some brilliant support within that. So there was a sense that all of these individual stakeholders within the city were starting to connect to engage with each other, and we were breaking down barriers. And that was something that was super powerful. People were constantly coming back to these events. And then from there, I suppose my career started to shift a little bit, because I was obviously teaching at the time. I was working in a classroom with young adults with intellectual and learning disabilities. From learning what was going on in that community, from building my own skills there, the company that I was working for and spotted what we were doing, and they came to me and said, well, look, we love what you're doing in the classroom. Could you do it for us as an organization as a whole? So I ended up working as an innovation project manager in there. And we have about 15,000 people with disabilities in Ireland that we support in training and education, and also in employment as well. And obviously a core part of that are the technologies that we can use that are inclusive, that are accessible, and that support them to go into the workforce, and also just to continue and to learn and develop to their potential as well. So there's plenty there, and it's not just about the technologies, you know yourself. It's about a rounded approach. And I think that's the key. It's like finding how you can bring everyone together to have those conversations. Some of them are tough to have, and to focus on the people. And I think that's really where we're at the moment. It's a big ecosystem. There's lots still to do. It's going well, but obviously, like every country, we need more investment.
What have been some of the most difficult challenges you had during these years of building the EdTech community?
That's a good question. I think it's always trying to find the value for different stakeholders, trying to understand why would somebody who's already well established want to engage with a grassroots community or a community of people who are doing it for free and are sharing information openly and doing that. Why would this university want to talk to that university or speak at the same thing? Or that, they're the kind of questions that we had in our minds. And I suppose it's very important to find individuals within those spaces that have the same philosophy and the same mindset, this idea of open resources and open sharing of information. And that really helped us to get, I suppose, a kind of a foot in the door with these organizations. And then from there, once they engage, they start to see the value themselves and they start to understand that this is powerful. People and building a community that's so big, that has thousands of people, even just within one city, that is useful in so many ways. And we started to build our brand around that, focusing on positive, purposeful communication, always giving recognition to people. And little by little, that brand started to become known, which was almost accidental in a way. We didn't really anticipate it would go so well. It was lovely to see that people coming on board, and then you would find that actually universities and other corporates were actually sending people, whether staff or other people who were engaged with it, to the events. And we were being asked to support bigger conferences and things like that. What we noticed was that there started to be a shift. Initially, we were very much about giving information, and then we started to shift into how do we bring people into a room together and start to get them acting on that information. That was really fun, and we started to see people really engaging with the likes of the design thinking processes within that space. The maker community was also a big part of that, which was really fun. And from there, I think that's where I decided that it was time for me to slowly step away from Learning Tech Labs and keeping my interest in educational technologies, but focus more on the practicalities of implementing things, making them tangible. We ran, for example, the Digital Citizenship Summit for the first time here in Ireland, which is co-founded by Dr. Mary Alice Curran in the States, which is all around supporting the safe and savvy ethical use of digital technologies. And we found that was really powerful. So we got a few hundred people who came along to that in the Science Gallery, basically teachers and stakeholders who realized that there was great technologies at the time, but there was not so much understanding of how to use them in a safe way and in a way that was most efficient and most effective, not only for the teacher themselves in terms of them being a citizen in a digital space, but also the student. And it was nice to see people who engaged with our events. As they came in, we brought them on board. They started to develop their skills and to move out into different spaces as well, into different organizations, taking those skills, bringing them in, and almost, you know, there was this sense of like bringing this new culture into some of the spaces in Dublin, which was lovely to see.
I know that the universities from Ireland, they work together closely regarding the research. How did it get to this point?
Ireland's so small. I think it's good to give a sense of the size of Ireland. There's pros and cons to being small, but it almost forces people to have conversations. I live in the middle of Ireland, and I am no more than 2 or 3 hours to any coast, and that's driving. That's not flying. Within that, you've got people who may have studied in one university on the east side of Ireland, and they may end up working over on the west side, but there's only maybe 2 hours in between. So the networks and the communities, the conferences, the events, people have built up personal relationships. I really wouldn't underestimate the personal relationships aspect for education. I think we all know it, whether it's with your students, whether it's with your staff, whether it's with colleagues, or within this case, maybe even people in competing organizations. There's an opportunity there to do really interesting things, and there's a lot of crossovers within that. One really good example of how universities came on board and worked together was actually through Techstars Startup Week in Dublin last year. So that was a 5-day celebration of entrepreneurship within Dublin City. It was supported by Dublin City Council, Enterprise Ireland, and myself and two of my friends run it in the city. And one of the things we went to the different universities, and we asked them, how do we make this valuable to students? We got talking to Dr. Roisin Lines, and she is a lecturer associate professor over in Dublin City University. She had the idea that, you know, we could potentially get Start of Week accredited for students to participate. So that was really exciting. That actually happened. Students actually got credits for attending the Start of Week as part of their entrepreneurship program because they were learning about this. Some participated. We saw a lot of different universities who couldn't get that accreditation over the line. They were all sending students to us, but they were also not just sending students, but they were running events and they were inviting in the other universities to see what was happening. So whether it was around student entrepreneurship or whatever it might be, there was this sense that they were all in it together. It was more about the students. You know, what were the students getting out of it? And I think always when you focus on students, when you focus on that, it's natural to start to want to collaborate because it makes a lot more sense. So that was one really positive experience where we had lots of students coming together. And we also, during the year, ran, this year actually, just before lockdown, we had the student startup weekend, which had universities coming in from all over. And again, the focus was not to have them as DCU groups or Trinity College groups, that it was a mixed group. So you would have people in from different universities and working together. So it wasn't about the university, whoever won, it was actually about the group of students. Within Ireland, we do have that opportunity to collaborate and work together face to face, maybe not in the current scenarios, but it's easy to drive across the country and to spend a bit of time with your peers and to work together and collaborate on that. It's not to say that Ireland's perfect or that universities always work together. There's constant competition for courses and writing your papers, making who's on top of all the lists. But I think we're starting to see a shift away from that a little bit. We're seeing really good results around hackathons and student entrepreneurship and the likes of the Enactus programs, which Roisin and our team were part of this year. And they're all positive things. You're taking the competitive nature of the universities, but putting into a positive learning experience for everybody.
You mentioned earlier transforming an idea into an actual product that people use. How does that happen in education?
There's a couple of elements from what I can see. One is where we've got educators who are teaching and they're full-time teaching and they're seeing firsthand the challenges that there are in the classroom or whatever the variable might be. They may know that out there are educational technologies somewhere, but they don't have the time or capacity to be able to evaluate what's currently out there. After evaluation, and maybe they'll find something that could potentially work, how do they implement that in an effective and efficient manner that fits in with their busy schedule? And then if there's nothing, how did they take a concept in their mind and put it into practice? One of the things we're trying to research at the moment around some of the either instructional design framework, some adapted models that we're using at the moment, one which is called the DADDY model, which starts with define, analyze, design, develop, implement, and then evaluate out the far side of it. So we've done that in a nice poster format for teachers to kind of fill out as they do it, and then afterwards they have a poster that they can share with their peers. But even within that, that takes up to 12 weeks with very, very minimal work in terms of writing and research. A lot of it's around instructional design, design thinking. Even the language that's there is a barrier for a lot of educators. There's a need to start to shift some of the language that's used and that we're familiar with in an entrepreneurial space, and to understand there's still a bit of a divide there, and we need to support them to feel comfortable and safe in the process of that. That's super for, you know, if there's a technology out there, but then on the far side, there may not be, whether you're involved in teaching and learning or whatever it might be. You're looking at, first and foremost, what your problem is. I think that's the key. A lot of people have great ideas or exciting ideas, but they're not problem focused. And I think if you have a problem, I think this is where quite educational technologies have a great opportunity, because you've got people on the front line seeing problems, actual issues that need to be solved. Therefore, there will be a value for ideas that come out that solve that. For example, understanding the need of the user first and foremost. And that's the crucial part of it, having that empathy stage. And then following simple design thinking processes that have the language that makes sense to them. Testing and prototyping, if we're looking at some of the standard design thinking models, it doesn't really make a lot of sense in education. But if you're working with a group of young adults who are on the autistic spectrum, or maybe some have intellectual disabilities along with that, maybe there's literacy issues. You want to go through a process. You want it to be as safe and as accessible to you as an instructor, because you've got all these other challenges that you have to deal with within a classroom setting, and you have to try and understand that. You really need to understand that person at the start. And I think with these frameworks, it's not as easy as, you know, maybe creating a product for other spaces. There are a lot more variables. If we're going to see educational technologies grow and develop, I think we need to start to put teachers as well as the students into that process. We need to start to co-design some of these solutions a little bit better, because I feel when we see some of them coming out, that there's been a lack of communication with what the actual needs are. So, for example, we look at some of the really amazing educational technology platforms that have been over the last 4 or 5 years that have been out there, but it's only recently that they've started to make them accessible in terms of having subtitles or captions, live captions for some of these events. And a platform in America called Beluga just started to do this as well. So we see Microsoft Teams adding in those elements as well. You know, if we're looking at universal design for learning, and we're looking at being inclusive and accessible, which is what education is at its core, I think we have a long way to go in terms of supporting the current platforms that are out there to go ahead, but also making sure that those are ideas that are kept when people are taking ideas from the classroom and the problems are there and putting them into practice.
What would be the most important aspects to take into account in order to make sure that your product or your tool is accessible and inclusive?
It's something that I think is probably overlooked by a lot of people at the start, because it's almost seen as a nice to have, but I think it needs to be integrated in the middle. To kind of give a concrete example of what that even is, it's, for example, if you use Twitter and use a hashtag, if you capitalize the first letters of each word, it makes it accessible for a screen reader, for somebody who may be blind or have a visual impairment. That's an example of what inclusion and accessibility is. I suppose inclusion, because you can access the platform but not include it in the conversation. I learned the hard way, because one of my friends is blind and he told me. He said, "You're not being accessible, David. You're talking about it, but you're not being accessible." And I think that was definitely a bit of a slap for me to just be careful. It's the same now that we have, even on Twitter and on some others, you have the option for alternative text, which mm-hmm. allows you just to put in like one or two words or a sentence on the picture, which means that when a screen reader comes along, they're able to get that information. And I think it's a learning process, isn't it? Like for everybody, it's being willing to ask those awkward questions, or, you know, the ones that we feel shy about or uncomfortable about. And just being willing to say we don't know. There are different platforms. I think there's no one size fits all. I think one of the questions that I get asked a lot, what is the best app for an autistic student? That's frustrating for me at times when you see a question like that, because that is not looking at what the challenge that student might have. If it's a literacy challenge, whether it's numeracy, engaging within a class, maybe it's a verbal communication. There's so many different tools. That's where we need to just get back to that empathy stage and just kind of say, well, what is exactly the problem or the challenge that is there, that, or the need, I should say, that needs to be dealt with? That is where we can learn a lot from the universities who are looking at assistive technology and also organizations who are doing that, merging those a little bit more with the educational technology space as well, whether it's a physical or intellectual or sensory disability. But now there needs to be the idea of taking what's been learned in the assistive technology space and bringing them into practice into the educational technology area as well. I'll probably finish up on this one story. We have a young student who just learned to drive, and he got his driving test, and he is autistic, and also he is deaf. He was driving along and his dad was sitting beside him, and the car stopped by the police, and the policeman didn't know how to communicate with the son, and proceeded to communicate directly with the dad, completely bypassing and undermining confidence and just a sense of value of that young student. And I got an email, and it was explaining the situation and trying to say, well, look, what do we do here? So the challenge really was, first of all, being able to communicate with that policeman or with a student or a teacher, whoever it might be, in any scenario, I'm deaf, so you need to just be patient with me. So that was one thing. And that was simply addressed by using an app called, I think it was Buzz Cards at the time. And it was just an ability to type in nice big bold writing that you can show on your screen in your phone for free. And you can have them set up in advance. So you could say, "Hi, I'm David. I am deaf. Please be patient and I will communicate with you via this." And that would have supported him within that. So we did that, which was super. And he was able to pre-program different sentences and things that he was using on a regular basis. So before that, he was using a big pack of cards that were starting to get a little bit dirty because he's using them all the time. Whereas now he can use his phone, and when he's going out with his friends, he doesn't have to have this pack. He now has his phone like anyone. Finally, within that, we also used live transcribe. What we did was we sat the phone down, and after the initial introduction, when I talked, I would pause and I would do one sentence, and he was able to read and communicate. And you could see by his reaction that he was just blown away, that he himself had not about this. With that, then he was able to use that within the classroom. In the classroom at the time, he had an assistant that would support, almost like a translator. He didn't need that after a certain amount of months, and that was all for free. If you go right down to the need, you'll find that people will probably be able to give you the solution almost themselves. So that was a positive story, I guess.
What are the current unexplored opportunities in education?
The future of education is definitely one that is on our mind all the time now. There was some interesting research from different organizations who are doing research into learning and development during this current situation, where we've got forced quarantine, push to remote learning, how learning and development strategies suddenly became outdated in the space of a few days or a week. We've seen that some who have had a tradition of learning and development and keeping up to date with different ways of supporting staff are now doing well, but the others who didn't see that as a priority are suddenly realizing, wow, we need to step up our game here. We need to support staff better. It's interesting because I work between different organizations like universities, charity sectors, startups. And the ones who have done well, from what I can see now, I've done no research in it, so it's just my word on this one. But we're seeing some organizations respond fantastically. It's almost like this smooth shift into this online learning space, which is not without its challenges. There's always onboarding of students to different platforms, whether it's Microsoft Teams, whether it's Google for Education, these collaborative platforms, Slack, whatever it might be. If there's a culture there, if people have been working in that space and had a sense that this was something that was their future already, they seem to have done really well. Then on the far side of that, we have organizations who were not prepared. They were not currently in the state to be able to shift into it. And that's not to say there's anyone's fault. The reality was that digital learning and remote learning and online learning had not been seen as a priority. There was, and there are, challenges currently there because of that. As organizations within Ireland anyway, a lot of us did not have the capacity to be able to fully deliver the training and learning that. That's somewhere that we need to start to look at more. We need to start to be able to support organizations to build up robust and flexible strategies, first and foremost, and also provide a space to test them out, pilot them out, learn during the process, because it's not a case of we're going to put in a platform now that's going to be the answer 10 years from now. That's just not the case. Culturally, within organizations, that's going to be the key. It's like the mindset shift. We need to see this shift in mindset of being willing to innovate, being willing to be lifelong learners, not just saying it to students and people who are working in the space. We need to be like that as well.
Thank you so much for this talk.
It was absolutely lovely to talk to you.